And we are rolling on April 27th here at UCLA, where it's a beautiful day. The sunshine is shining. No global warming here. Eat your heart out, East Coast. Okay. So Vidya stands before us. She needs to get in the power stance, feet wider than your shoulders, like a tripod, a little bit wider, good. You don't sway, no hands in the pocket. You're gonna put your hands in your pocket, take that jacket off. She's looking around the room to make sure all phones are away, all computers are closed, no one's reading, all eyeballs are upon her. She communicates respect non-verbally. She says to herself as she looks around and really means it, I respect my audience. Finding friendly eyes near the front and the center, say your name. Feel the love. Start your speech.
Hi, my name is Vidya.
Hi, Vidya.
Hi. So I'm going to start up my speech like this. Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase. Hakuna Matata. It ain't no passing craze. Today I want to speak to you about a film that deeply moved me, as I'm sure it moved anybody who has ever watched it. Disney's The Lion King. It made me happy, it made me sad, and it made me scared. And I think that any film that has the potential to do that is one of like the really good films that everybody should watch. It's been reviewed before. For example, Elizabeth Whiteman of the New York Daily Times said that everyone, young and old, can find something to appreciate in this Shakespearean tale about a young lion who finds his place in the world. She gave it 4 of 5 stars, which I think is a travesty, because there is no review of The Lion King that is an accurate review unless it gives you 5 of 5 stars. I'm going to tell you how it made me feel. Because the incident in The Lion King that made me feel very, very happy was the moment right after after Mufasa's death, when Simba, the young lion, finds Timon and Pumbaa, who take him in and make him laugh. Because he's really sad, he's really lost. But then Timon cracks a joke about when he asks him what a motto is, and he goes, nothing, what's the motto with you? The reason it made me feel happy, even though it was like a pretty terrible joke, is that it reminded me of a time when I was feeling really sad and somebody was able to make me happy in the same way. For example, like right before when I was applying for colleges, I got a rejection from a school that I really wanted to go to. And I was feeling really bad. One friend of mine came up to me, and while I was like feeling really lost and really angry and resentful and like having low self-esteem, my friend told me a really lame joke about cookies where she asked me what one cookie says to the other, and it was like, it's hot in here, isn't it? And the other cookie says, oh my god, a talking cookie. Which I thought was a pretty terrible joke. But given that, it was just nice to know that there was someone who was trying to make me laugh in a time when I was sad, unhappy, and feeling somewhat lost. The second thing this movie made me feel, like the second incident within the movie, that it made me feel really sad, was the point where Simba returns to the Pride Lands, his home, and he sees that it's all like a place that used to be so beautiful and full of grass and greenery and like a thriving ecosystem is now like burned, deserted, and is destroyed. What it reminded me of was when I went back after many years to my home in Mumbai, I had this image of my childhood home as this really beautiful place. There used to be gardens where we used to have Christmas parties, even though like none of us were actually Christian. We used to have like these long fields where we would all play, go down to play, and we'd run away from cars, and we'd all just have a lot of fun. In my mind, it was that beautiful place, and it would continue to be that beautiful place, and I expected it to wait for me. But when I went back, it was completely different. The place was urbanized, it was deserted, it was also clinical. The grass was no longer like this free garden, but it was like very well maintained into these like rows and columns, and it seemed very mathematical. And it was no longer like this fun, vibrant, like organic place that I remembered from my childhood. It made me sad, and that's what the Pride Lands reminded me of, because it reminded me that the place I expected, or the childhood home I had built up in my mind, was no longer the same and was not waiting for me anymore. The third thing that The Lion King made me feel was it made me feel really, really scared. I'm sure everybody remembers Mufasa's death when Simba finds out that his father was killed. What it reminded me of at the time and what it made me feel was really scared, because it reminded me of the time of when I went to this orphanage in Cambodia. I met a bunch of these kids, and I was just like having fun with them. We were like teaching them how to sing, dance, and paint. But what, as I spoke to them a little more, they told me about how they could remember their own parents' deaths, how they could remember how like they used to be happy before, but then something like an accident or a fire happened, and now they were lost. What it made me feel was really scared, because for the first time I realized how much I relied on my parents for a support system. It made me realize that my parents were not, though they seemed amazing to me, were not like invincible or immortal, and that you never know what could happen, and you never know when you'd have to fend for yourself. That thought really scared me, because I felt really lost, and I had this like mini existential crisis. That's what watching The Lion King and watching Mufasa's death made me feel, because it showed me a kid who was lost and who didn't know what to do without his father. So, in summary, I've shown you how The Lion King made me feel three really profound emotions. It made me feel really happy, because it reminded me of my friend trying to cheer me up. It made me feel really sad, because it reminded me about how you can lose your childhood homes and things aren't the same as you remember them. And it made me feel very scared, because it reminded me of the time that I realized my parents would not be around forever. In conclusion, there should be no doubt that The Lion King is definitely worth a watch, because any movie that can make you feel these emotions so profoundly is a movie that is universal in its appeal, and it's amazing in its creation. Like I said, with Hakuna Matata, as with its catchphrase, Hakuna Matata, this film is no passing craze. I urge you all to watch the movie and feel as well about it as I have. Thank you.
Thank you. What was the time?
5:33.
5:33. Okay. Remember, we were to time our speeches, and we'll have to stop you if someone's going real long. So that'll be your job.
Oh.
Like at 6, you know, let me know.
At 6?
At 6,
okay.
Yeah. Hi. Stand up for Buddha.
Hi, Emily.
Hi, Emily.
I liked how genuine your speech was. It flowed very well.
Flowed well, genuine, Emily. Improvement.
Hi, I'm Louisa.
Hi, Louisa.
Hi, Louisa.
I think you did a really good job. I think you could work on like walking during like the different
parts of speech. Yeah. Okay, Vidya. What was you had your speech on your phone, right, or kind of sitting there as a cheat sheet?
Mm-hmm.
Please, for credibility purposes, no notes next time. You're a very smart girl, woman, whatever. Don't use notes. You don't have to. It's time to get away from that trainer wheels on your bike, okay? And let your memory come alive. Like your speech, like the topic. Yeah, Lion King speaks to adults and children, and it spoke to you, and that's excellent. You had some extra filler words. I am going to start my speech with a interesting expression instead of just starting your speech, right? Hakuna Matata, right? Mm-hmm. What a wonderful phrase. Just jump into it. Knock us out with, you know, right, go right to your speech. Your thesis preview, Disney's Lion King, Happy, Sad, and Scared Me, was fine. When you watch yourself tonight on YouTube, notice some of the ums, and when you practice with a live person, have them raise their hand when you have those kinds of fillers so that you lose them. Okay. On your significant statement and your quote from the New York Daily News, I don't know. Did I hear it? Did I miss it? Did I hallucinate it? You said, everyone young and old finds something to appreciate in this Shakespearean tale, and she got 4 out of 5 stars. Yeah, that's where the review goes, but the second part is it deals such thing with circle of life, justice, vengeance, power, and friendship. You needed to stress that a little bit more, okay? So we don't just get a quote from the newspaper. One thing I want you to compliment you on is you said you disagreed. So I want you to say whether you agree or disagree with the quote you're putting in your speech. Okay, let's talk about your emotion, happy. First off, let me compliment you on being short with your plot summary. Yes, good. You told us of, you got a rejection letter. From where?
It was from Wellesley College.
Wellesley? You aimed high. That would be good to know. And that detail helps us know about you and gives us more insight why you were upset that Wellesley rejected you, right? So tell us more, reveal more, disclose more, Vidya. Don't be so hidden and coy. And your friend cheered you up and told you a corny joke about a cookie, and you went from sad to happy. And so I guess I bought it, and it was okay. On sad, again, a nice short, plot summary. There was destruction. That's all you needed. Mumbai, yeah. Well, everything changes, really. But I could feel your sadness. What I would like you to do more of is do more felt sensing of really reliving that emotion that you felt when you first landed and went, wow, where's my garden? Wow, what's that hotel doing there? Oh my God, this is not Mumbai. I don't want to be here. All right? Refeel that, and then as you're refeeling it, we'll feel it too, Vidya. Yeah. So, I like the fact you had a Christmas party. I don't think you had to tell us that you're not a Christian. We won't think less of you if you're a Christian.
Yeah.
Right? I realize it's not popular to be a Christian on this campus, but, that's no big deal.
To illustrate that we just used to celebrate for
celebrate a lot of holidays, yeah. And I like the way you return back to the emotion at the end. And I want you all to do that. To return to the emotion you're communicating at the end, and you say, and that's why seeing Mumbai and the condition that it had become, I felt really sad, okay? Because that helps the audience know what your emotion, your feeling, and re-communicating. Unscared. This was a tricky one because it took a little bit of doing. You told us you went to an orphanage in Cambodia. And the children told you very scary stories. But essentially, in an orphanage, none of them had their mother or father. They were gone. They were... And you described an existential moment when you said, what? If my parents died, what if I was an orphan? And that's when you kind of went into this existential, wow, and you became a little scared. I wish you had described it a little bit more, the feeling, and verbalized it a little bit more, and said, I don't know what I would do. They've booked my action. They've paid for my school. Blah, 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 blah. They've supported me with their love and emotional support. I would just be lost if I was an orphan. That's why I felt sad. Summary was good. The conclusion should say there should be, you can say what you said. You should also say the thesis, which is the film moved me. So we need to say the Lion King really moved me. There should be no doubt in this room that the Lion King really moved me. That's your thesis. That's what a conclusion is. You didn't do much. You tied back to Hakuna Matata, but you didn't really do much with it and say what it meant or, you know, do something fancy with it that would have made it better. Okay, now, that was the speech. Let's talk about you holding your hands like you do so much like that. Let's practice walking. Show me you know how to walk. First off, when were you instructed to walk during your speeches?
The first point and the second point.
And the third point. Mm-hmm. Only in the main body. Why were you instructed to walk?
So that you could reach out to the people here and
there in the center. Also, it does something for you. It relaxes your body. You hold tension in your muscles when you're walking. The tension goes away. When did you walk, Vidya?
In the beginning.
In the middle of something.
Yeah.
Pourquoi, as they say in Paris.
Yeah.
But why?
The when I was talking about the quote from the New York Daily Times.
Yeah, why? But why did you walk then? Because you do this in debate rounds too, it drives me crazy. You know, you're in the middle of a point and you just start moving. And the point loses a little of its intensity because you move over. When you're making a point, you're supposed to laser point into people, right? So let's see you walk and talk. Tell us about your morning. First to the right, three. To the left, five, and back to center for three.
Okay. So the first thing I did today morning was I missed my alarm, as in I slept right through it, and I had to rush, get ready, and then make it to class on time, which I almost missed. And then the second thing I did today morning was I got...
That's only three. You need to take an extra step to really work this side. There's only three steps, four, five.
Okay.
There you go.
The second thing I did was I got a cup of hot chocolate because there's no way I was getting through that class.
Relax your hands, let them be by your side, yeah.
There was no way I was getting through that class without caffeine in my system. So I needed to get hot chocolate because otherwise I'd fall asleep in front of the TA. And the third thing I did today morning was I didn't do much. I just got lunch after that. And then I came for this class.
Great. Okay. Give Vidya some feedback on her walking.
So at first, obviously, like, you didn't go far enough to our side. Also, one thing that Professor Wilson did last class is like you should look at the other side of the audience too when you walk over here.
Give them a glance so they're not blown off. So you're working Kiara over here and staring at her a little bit for 3 to 5 seconds. Give a glance over there. So you look, glance over so they don't feel completely left out, then come back. See? Okay, one other thing, which is you always cheat forward when you walk. You turn your shoulder almost to the audience. Keep your eye on the prize. Never take your eye off the audience and how they're reacting and what they're doing. When you turn to the side, your eyeballs can't be on your audience, and you can't do audience analysis then. Okay, I think that's enough, Vidya. Let's end on a positive note. I like your speech. I like the speech you chose, and I like the story about Mumbai and the story of you worrying about losing your family. That would be, that. Those were your two good parts of the speech to me. Thank you. Okay, do we have more volunteers? Now that more A's?
Woo! The introduction is going to be a little bit different though. Okay? Just don't.
Hey. Life is beautiful. By the way, let me comment on something.
Okay.
Get in the power. Stay up there. Alan almost did something I was afraid he was going to do, but he didn't do it, so I'm pleased with that. Folks, it's important when you come up. You ever see a speaker that comes up and apologizes before a speech? I was up all late last night, so I'm really tired. I'm really sick. I got a sore throat. Other kinds of stuff. Appealing to pity. Man up, woman up, you know. Just get up there and do it. Don't ever apologize to your audience. Don't seek cheap pity. Just go up there and do it. Okay. Now, the second thing that I want to compliment Alan on is he said, I changed my introduction. And I like that because I like the fact that people aren't just writing their speeches and go, okay, I wrote it, that's the speech I'm going to give. I want you to be thinking about your speeches as you're walking across campus, as you're laying in bed, as you're sitting at dinner. I like to be thinking, was my introduction good enough? I realize I'm placing more importance in this class than maybe you do, but that's what I want you to do. And so when he said, I've changed my introduction, I thought to myself, great. He's editing. He's changing. He's improving. That's good.
It's also the format's kind of changed too, so it's going to be a little off for you. Okay.
No problemo, as they say somewhere. Okay. Alan stands before you. Wait a minute, I've cut your head off. There it is. Managing attention. All phones are away, computers closed, eyeballs on the speaker. That's a nervous thing, huh? Communicating respect non-verbally, saying to yourself, I really respect my audience and mean it. Finding friendly eyes near the front and the center, say your name, feel the love, start your speech.
Did somebody ask for a volunteer? Let me hear you say, ah.
Ah.
Close enough. Now, Professor Miller has sent me today to guide you through my speech. And if you fall asleep during my speech, the penalty is death. Now, some of you might be thinking, who is he? Who am I? Who am I? I am the guardian of lost souls. I am the powerful, the pleasurable, the indestructible Alan. And I'm going to tell you about my favorite movie, Mulan. I'm going to tell you about an incident in the movie that scared me, that inspired me, and made me have joy in my life. Now, Michael O'Sullivan from the Washington Post says the movie is like an epic like Lawrence of Arabia and has an emotional appeal of Bambi. And I couldn't agree more. I probably further exacerbated that I thought Mulan had a better emotional appeal to me than Bambi because I didn't care about Bambi's mom. That's another. For starters, I'm going to tell you about what scared me about the movie. In the very introductory scene, a man is just walking on the Great Wall, and then you see this falcon come out of nowhere. He sees the Huns are attacking and runs to light the signal flare. And there you see him, Sean Yu. Because of him, not in a racist way, I am still scared of Mongolian people. And then when he put the light, he said, now all of China will know that you will be coming. He said, perfect. Now this reminds me to a time, actually, that something happened to me recently. We had a guest who was drunk and violent and pushed our manager, and then he left the building. My manager told me to follow the guest so that I could pinpoint him for the cops. But as I was following him, he spotted me, and he actually started chasing me across the street. This guy was so intoxicated that he almost got hit by oncoming traffic, but still continued to chase me. And I kept running into a parking garage. And there he was, standing about 5 feet away from me, about as how far the person was from Sean Yu. And I literally got lucky. I dived into a parking garage and just bolted, never looking back. So that scene, I kind of felt like he did next to Sean Yu. So that's definitely a scene that had like some emotional, scaring connection when I rewatched it. More upbeat, I'm going to tell you a scene that kind of inspired me. During everybody's favorite song, Make a Man Out of You, during the final stretch of it, when Mulan's being sent home, she decides that she's going to prove herself. She's going to get on top of that stick. And rather than trying to brute force her way through the metals, she uses her brain. She uses the weights to her advantage. And she uses the weights to help her climb up. Now, in high school, when I was struggling with classes, if anybody has ever taken a class with me at UCLA, they'll notice one thing. I don't take notes. I haven't taken notes in 4 years, and me not taking notes has actually benefited me as a student. Because instead of trying to jot down everything that the teacher is saying, I tried to do what, instead of having to take the weights by my side, I use it to my advantage. I actually just pay attention to what he's saying, and I'm an oral listener, so whatever he says, I remember it that way, rather than looking it down on my notes. So doing this change, being smart about it, has actually benefited me as a UCLA student, and I actually have better grades in UCLA than I ever did in high school as a result. Now I'm gonna finally tell you about one of my favorite scenes in Mulan. It's in the final scene when Mulan's getting congratulated, and everybody just bows at her. Even the Emperor gives her a slight nod, and then as she gallops away, the Emperor tells Shang, says, "The flower that blooms in adversity is the most beautiful and rare flower." Shang's like, "What the hell are you talking about?" He's like, "Girls like Mulan don't show up every dynasty," and then he goes and chases her. Now, in regards to high school as well, I wasn't going to graduate because I had like 35 absences in one of my classes, but I was still succeeding in class. I didn't want to go to graduation, but my mom was there saying, "You know, this is something that's only going to happen once in your life. Go there. If not for you, do it for me." So, as a punishment for having 35 absences, the school decided to suspend me. Ironic that they'd take me away from class as punishment for not being in class. And so I took that suspension. It was an in-class suspension, so I just sat in the office just so that I can please my mom and I can please my family by graduating on stage. And rewatching that scene, although I haven't found my Mulan and I'm Shang, you know, watching the flower go away, that scene really touched me. And everybody loves a good love story in that movie, and it just really makes me feel good every time I watch that scene. And I've told you a little bit about how Mulan scares me. Even Sean Yu still scares me. If I ever see his picture, I'll just turn away. I'll tell you how it inspired me to look at school in a different way. And I'll tell you how it brings joy to me every time I watch the movie. Now, although it's like Lawrence of Arabia and like Bambi, something I disagree with Michael O'Sullivan, though, is he hated Mushu's role in Mulan. He said that whole introductory segment that I gave, the preacher part, he despised it. So Michael O'Sullivan should be rescinded from any critic license. That guy has absolutely no idea what he's talking about. And thank you, guys.
Five seventeen.
Okay, thank you. Another page here. Okay, good. I wanted to mention, I forgot to mention this in Vidya's outline, but in her outline, she used the Chicago format with a footnote at the bottom of the page. So make sure you use Chicago. Let's all say Chicago.
Chicago.
Good. Okay, where are we? Over here? Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Sydney.
Hi, Sydney.
I really liked your speech, and I think that you're very passionate about it, which made it more interesting for us to listen to, and it seemed not just like an assignment you had to do, and something that you clearly care about, and yeah, I enjoyed how genuine it was.
Thank you. Improvement?
Yeah, I loved your energy. It was really awesome. I'd say, yeah, the one improvement, I think the bringing in the Mushu scene at the end seemed a little bit random and didn't work with the movement of your speech as a whole.
Yeah. Let me start on a positive note and then give you some feedback and comment on your felt sensing. I like the quote that you presented from the Washington Post from Michael O'Sullivan and the way you humorously sort of responded to it, kind of agreed but didn't, so that was good. I always like the use of humor, you know, that's a good thing. to do. I also want to compliment you on your introduction. It was creative and unique and different, and I think it got our attention. Let me talk about your speech. I don't want to use that analogy, so I'll censor myself. But when you start too loud or too fast or too loud, you don't have any place to go, right? And when you watch yourself tonight on YouTube, you're going to see that you were really pretty forceful and loud in the beginning, not just with your introduction, but in the beginning part of it. And which was fine if you had cut back and gone soft and then gone loud again. But I don't recommend that you come on so strong in the beginning, there's no place to go. Like the intro, thesis good, SIG statement good, except the significant themes that I know you'll be interested, I wish you had thrown one or two in. Okay, no big deal though, but just don't leave it so general, you know. So the first emotion that you were trying to convince us that you had from the movie was scared. And the story you told us, you are a bartender at a movie theater, and your boss told you to chase a drunk.
It's a terrible choice.
I think I told the story in this class. I used to work in a gas station when I was in high school, and I was robbed. And my boss, after the robbers and the police left, my boss handed me a gun and said, here, use it if the guy comes back. And I said, you are out of your mind. If you think I'm going to die for a gallon of gas and a can of oil, and I quit. You know, but I don't know if I would automatically chase somebody because my boss told me to. I think that would be a time to say goodbye, but that's just me. Anyway, but so on the story that you told, it was pretty exciting, pretty interesting. And we kind of got the excitement of it, of that you were scared. What would have brought the emotion more home is if you first started out by saying, the first way the film was, it made me scared, with your voice to emphasize it, and then return to the emotion at the end, and you say, and getting out of that parking lot alive, I've never been so scared in all my life. Relive it, refill it, let us relive it and refill. Remember how scared you were. Let us remember it and refill it. And then in feeling it, we'll make it a better emotional connection with you, you see? Second emotion, inspired. Well, let me be kind here. I didn't really get the inspired. I'm glad that you have a photographic memory, or you found a good way to go through college without taking notes, and you just listen and concretize and think of what the professor's saying, and it works for you, and that's great. What I didn't get so much was the inspiration of that, where it came from, where it goes. You're inspired, your professor's inspired, your parents are inspired. I got you telling a story that you're proud you don't take notes in college. But I didn't get the inspired so much, see? Okay. On the joyful, this was a little better. The story was that your mother, rightly so, wanted you to walk in graduation, but because you were absent 35 times in one class, they did not want to let you walk. You took a suspension, and you were allowed to walk. what you didn't come back to and sort of, you sort of told the story really well, but you forgot why you were telling the story, which was to say, and this made me feel joyful when I saw how happy my mom was. And I felt joyful too, because damn it, you know, I graduated from high school, you know, and not everyone does that anymore, you know, and blah, 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 blah. And so remember how you felt, refeel it, most importantly, say it. Folks, I'm saying this to Alan, but I hope you all are putting it in your notes. Repeat the emotion at the end of your storytelling of each section. Write it in right now if you have to, so you remember to do it. Yeah. Summary? Good. Conclusion? Well, we heard about Lawrence of Arabia. And we heard about Bambi. I would like to have heard that this really did move you. In addition to these things you said about Lawrence of Arabia and so forth. You tied back to your quote, which was interesting, because you had such a dramatic introduction. I wondered why you didn't go back to that. Were you afraid to? Was it too much? Or why didn't you go back to it in some clever way? Do you see what I mean?
Yeah. I think the original thing was, when I first wrote the introduction, I was supposed to like actually recite Mushu's way of saying. It was a minister basically saying.
Yeah.
And then Michael O'Sullivan criticized it, and I just found it to be ironic and wanted to end on that. Like, that scene we all just laughed at, the critics hated it. That's how I kind of wanted to end, but I...
You didn't, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. But do you see what I mean, that you could have possibly restated some of the words that you started in the beginning and had a clever, loudish kind of ending and sort of ended on a bang instead of a whimper, right? It's what you always want to do. Overall, don't get me wrong, I've given you a lot of feedback and criticism, but it was a decent, good speech. And thank you for going so early and volunteering and doing this. It was good. Thank you. Okay, do we have another A? Any more A's? Let's see. Oh, Mr. Park. Mr. Park is on deck.
Okay,
Mr. Park. Thank you, sir. Did you give me the time on that? It was 5:19, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Just yell it out at the end. I'll write it down. Thanks. Why don't you put it on the other side of the chair? Yeah, good. Thank you. Okay, are you ready, sir? Okay. Moses stands before you, managing attention, looking around, making sure all phones are away, all computers are closed, all eyeballs are upon you. You're swaying a little, so don't do that. Put your feet a little wider apart so you're not going to sway. Lock your legs a little bit. Yeah, that's good. You're going to look around the room and communicate respect nonverbally. Say to yourself, I respect my audience. And really mean it. Finding friendly eyes near the front and the center. Say your name. Feel the love. Start your speech.
Hello, everyone. My name is Moses.
Hi, Moses.
My dear Mrs. Ryan, it is with the most profound sense of joy that I write to inform you your son, Private James Ryan, is well, and at this very moment, on his way home from European battlefield. I take great pleasure in joining the Secretary of War, the man and woman of the United States Army, and the citizen of a great nation, in wishing you good health and many years of happiness with James at your side. This is a letter written by the General James C. Marshall, who was commanding the force in the Europe during the World War II. This letter was sent to the mother who lost three of her children during the war. He was informing the mother that her last child, James Ryan, was returning home safely. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Today I want to share with you a film that really inspired me to think about pretty much everything. The film that I wanted to introduce is Saving Private Ryan. I know that every one of you will find this film very interesting and very inspiring because it not only tells us about the people who fought for the freedom, but the price they paid and what government must be. A movie critic from the Empire, William Thomas, said that this movie is the perfect war, is a powerful war movie that perfectly balances the inhumanity of war with the humaneness of the protagonist. I will going to show you how this movie first made me feel more grateful and patriotic, and lastly, feel love. So, how this movie made me smile? It really began when I watched these soldiers interacting with each other. I myself served in the military for 2 years. These people were just normal citizens. They were just like us, sitting in the college campuses, working in their jobs, but drafted by the government to fight for the freedom. Watching these soldiers interacting with each other, talking, laughing, joking, sleeping, just reminded me of the 2 years that I spent with my brothers. Even though we were from radically different background, during these 2 years, we became one unit of body. And even though we were from very different socioeconomic classes, at the end of the day, we became like brothers and we really loved each other. And watching these soldiers in the movie, talking to each other, really reminded me of the experiences that I had. The second that I received from this movie is it made me more grateful and more patriotic. My home country, South Korea, was invaded by North Korea, and millions of people died during the war. And it reminded me the freedom that we enjoy today here at UCLA campus was possible because these people laid their lives for us. Watching this film, I used to like war movies because I love seeing explosion. I thought it was really cool, shooting guns, explosion, bombs and stuff. But after going through military, it really reminded me it's not all about the explosion, it's not all about the guns and fighting. It's all about the message that's behind the scene. It's the people who die for the cause and for the freedom. Lastly, this movie really reminded me about the love. I studied politics and the government, and watching the government really care for the individual lives really struck me. Because government deals with the big stuff, it deals with the economy, deals with wars, conflicts, etc. It's really easy to forget about what really matters. And watching these generals writing letters for the moms who lost three of her children, and informing her that they were going to find her last children, her last son, and bring him back home, really struck me because it really showed that government care about the individual lives. As a political science major, it really tells me what government must be, and this is what I really believe. So watching this scene was really good reminder for me. In summary, I've shown you the three how this film inspired me in three different ways. It made me smile because it reminded me of the brothers that I met in the military. It made me feel more patriotic and grateful because it reminded me of the price they paid for the freedom. And lastly, it made me feel love because it showed me government sometimes can be acting upon humanity's cost. Before I end my speech, I want to go back to the quote that the letter that I read for you, and there's a second part of the letter. Nothing, not even the safe return of the beloved son, can compensate you or the thousands of other American families. I might share with you some words which have sustained me through long, dark night of peril, loss and heartaches. And I quote, I pray that our Heavenly Father may assuage the anguish of your bereavement and leave you only the cherished memory of love and lust, and the solemn pride that must be yours to have laid so costly a sacrifice upon the altar of freedom. Too often, we sometimes watch war movies just for the violence and just for the fighting scenes. But I believe that there's more to that. I think the Saving Private Ryan was a great film because it reminded me the important values that we often take it for granted.
That's 6 minutes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Was it 6 minutes and something? 4 seconds? Say 6 minutes and 4 seconds. Moses. Where are we at? Here, yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Alec.
Hi, Alec.
And one thing I really appreciated about your speech was that it had like an overarching theme of like introspection, like all your stories like had to deal with you like realizing or coming to these like revelations, and I liked that that was like a single thread that went through all three of your examples.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Luke.
Hi, Luke.
So obviously went over a little bit. It was a great speech, but I think you just need to like work on making your points more succinct and clear so that you can just get in that time limit.
Yeah. Moses. Well, gosh. Like the novelty of you reading the letter that General James Marshall wrote to Mrs. Ryan, maybe a little long. What was he, about a minute in when he finished that introductory part? Yeah. So he maybe could use a little editing, you know. But it was a novel and creative idea to start with it. It was certainly better than a rhetorical question. Better than no introduction at all. And it sort of set the pace. I think most people have seen Saving Private Ryan. We didn't really need a plot summary so much. But you didn't give a long one, but it was creative, so thank you for that. Your three points were, the feeling was, made you smile, feel grateful, and feel love. So I guess if we were to be consistent, we would want to say happy, grateful, and feel love, okay? But, okay, I quibble. Your significant statement was okay. Your quote from William Thomas was fine. On your main body, here's where I had a little problem. And let me give you the overall problem that I had and then go through the specifics of all three. I just didn't get a lot of the real Moses or a lot of personal stuff out of you. I got a little bit, but mostly generalizations. And I didn't really get a strong emotional connection from you, to be blunt about it. And that was the purpose of the speech. So if you can work on learning to find the emotions that are there, reliving them and communicate them, you'll be more effective at making emotional connection. Okay, I'll give you an example. So you said that it made you smile, and soldiers, and you reminisced about when you were in the military in South Korea, and it, you sort of said, yeah, kind of was happy, and it was just sort of just a general thing. Could there have been a beer party? Could there have been a something that you all went out and did something? Could there have been a specific story or example where we could really believe you were happy? I think it would have been more effective if you had that. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. On the second one, on patriotic. Here you said, it reminds me of the simple fact that freedom is not free. Right. don't disagree with you. I'm a patron, just like many people are. But where's the emotion in that? Where's the gratefulness in that? You don't articulate your own feelings about it. You don't articulate your own maybe feelings of you being proud that you served. And blah, 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 blah. But I didn't get any emotion. I just got a sentence.
Yeah.
And I didn't get a story. So the third one, love. Okay, this is a big one. And here you said you were amazed that the government did some good. And so that's what made you feel love. Okay? That's a scene from the movie. That's not a something that reminds you of something that happened in your life when the government did something for you or someone showed love for you unexpectedly. And that's what you were supposed to do, see? Yeah. So, your summary was fine. Your conclusion, I want to hear, there should be no doubt in this room that the film Saving Private Ryan really did move me. And I loved your tie back, except that it went long. Your canise step with the main body you did, don't sway and don't say how'd it go?
I realized I was start swaying actually in the first few seconds, then I realized I tried to stop.
Yeah.
You know, how it went after all, I kind of like lose track of my body.
Yeah.
That's
okay.
And I definitely need to more practice memorizing the script.
Right.
That's why I keep saying so I guess third part I still need to practice more.
If you do it about 6 times and you have someone else hold your outline, you put it on a card, by the 6th time you won't need the card and they can prompt you on the few little spots that you can't do. That's what I found it takes to be cardless and phoneless and to do it properly. But don't miss my major criticism here, which was of the thrust of the assignment. You still need to work on learning to make an emotional connection effectively, okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any other A's besides the ones that learned they were A's today? Okay, it's B time. Oh, it's not B time. It's